Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, August 14th, 2016. It's the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. Our pastor is the Reverend John J. Pollock. It's a little wet out today. It's our annual church picnic this afternoon. Hoping the sun comes out.
Therefore, declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins bulletin, and open with over 1,000 comes to sing and breathe.
St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is August the 14th. This hymn is written by Charles Wesley. Lived 1707 to 1789. And Charles Wesley was one of the founders of the Methodist Church.
Giving judgment in the midst.
readings from Hebrews chapters 11 and 12, verses 29 through verse 2. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as if it were dry land. But when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had received the spies in peace. And what more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death. They were sawn in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats. Destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. Yet all of these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better so that they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, is preparing to read the Gospel.
According to St. Luke, the 12th
chapter of the Gospel.
Jesus said,
Pollock is reading.
I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish you were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is complete. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. Now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He also said to the crowd, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, it's going to rain. And so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be a scorching heat, and it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May be seated as we sing, Come Christians, Join to Sing, which is actually page 5 in the worship bulletin, not 4. Got reversed. So it's page 5.
Come Christians, join us. Come Christians, join us.
We believe that God is the author of all life in heaven and on earth. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of life. He died on the cross to defeat the power of death, and was raised again to bring resurrection and life to all who trust in him.
He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity.
We believe the Spirit of God is alive among us, daily giving us new birth, filling us with grace and truth, and bringing us into one life with each other, in harmony with the whole creation. We praise God for all. You may be seated, and I ask that you give your attention to Pam, who brings our special music for this week.
Part of the Olympics was always the track and field events. And it was
enjoyed sports, and their culture was permeated with sports. Not only did they have track and field in the Roman Empire and continue the Olympic Games and other games where track and field athletes and boxers and wrestlers competed, but they brought those chariot races and the gladiator games and other kinds of athletic contests. And so the society was constantly aware of sports. And because of this emphasis on athletes and their competition, I believe this is what influenced many of the New Testament writers, especially St. Paul, but also the apostle who writes our letter today, as well as John and James, oftentimes use sports imagery in describing the life of faith. Athletics so well describes or compares to us running our life of faith until we are called to our heavenly home. And so, even today, many people like to use sports images in order to make points, whether it is in the world of faith, or politics, or economics, or education, no matter what field you may be in, it's still very popular. And many people today like to use the imagery of life being a race. We all have this race of life to run. And as could be imagined, like so many things in life, there are plenty of people who want to share with us what they consider to be the way to run our race of life and obtain the fullest benefit of that race and of that wealth. Go to any chain bookstore, like Barnes & Noble or Million Books or any other chain, and you will see a large section dedicated to what are called self-help books. Books written by authors telling you how to live life to the fullest. And even in Christian bookstores, you can find a section, not as large as in secular bookstores, but you can find a section of self-help books written by Christian personalities who supposedly are giving us somewhat biblical advice on how to run our race of life. But none of that is important, and none of that matters, because it doesn't compare with the apostle writing his letter to the Hebrews. Because the apostle gives to us true biblical knowledge and understanding on how to continue running the race of life. As he writes this letter, he is writing to a community evidently predominantly of Jewish Christians, of Jewish converts to the Christian faith. And these Jewish Christians are beginning to waver in their commitment to Jesus Christ because of continuous persecution. So within their community, they are beginning to raise questions. They are beginning to ask themselves and one another, is it all worth it? Should we continue in this Christian faith, running the race of life through faith in Christ? Or should we go back to our old ways, to the ways of Judaism and the laws of Moses? And so the apostle is writing this letter to the Hebrews to show to them the superiority of Jesus over the Old Testament covenant. He begins by recounting everything from creation throughout the history of Israel and Judah. And he makes it quite clear in his speaking that Jesus Christ is superior to the angels and far superior to Moses, the patriarchs, and the prophets. That what the old covenant had cannot compare to the new covenant. And so they need to continue in the new covenant and to run their race of life in Jesus Christ. In chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, our text for today, he says, now, what I'll be reading is an English Standard Version of the Bible. On your insert, that's the New Revised Standard Version. So there's a couple of word differences, some which I'll point out. But he says, quote, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside cling so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. End of quote. So the apostle begins in this first verse of the 12th chapter by assuring us that we are not alone in running our race of life. Sometimes you in life you will meet someone who feels totally alone. They're depressed, they're downhearted, they feel like there's no one who cares about them. But the apostle is assuring us that as we run our race of life through faith in Jesus Christ, we have this great cloud of witnesses that is cheering us on. The imagery here is of a stadium, athletic stadium, filled to overflowing with people watching the athletes below competing in the track and field events. The athletes are those of us who are still running our race of life. The witnesses or the spectators are those who go before us in the faith. As he is writing this, he is talking predominantly about the Old Testament. People like Abraham, Noah, Moses, David, and Solomon, and all the prophets, and also those apostles who already have been martyred, St. Stephen, the first martyr, and other Christians who have been martyred during the persecutions. As we hear him speak today, that crowd is composed of not only those people, but everyone who has followed in faith in Jesus Christ. It contains not just the giants of our faith like St. Peter and St. Paul. It does not just contain the early leaders of the church like Pollock and Irenaeus. It does not contain just the great early theologians of the church like St. Jerome and St. Augustine and St. Ambrose and St. Gregory the Great and St. John Chrysostom. It not only holds the giants like Martin Luther and Philip Melanchthon and others, but it is made up of us common men, of our grandparents, our parents, our aunts and uncles, our best friends, our brothers and sisters, and in some cases, even our children. He is telling us that they are now in that great cloud, cheering us on each day, telling us to pick ourselves up and to continue on with the race of life, that no matter how difficult the race course may be, that through that faith in Christ, we can continue and run the race of life successfully. And then he gives us that advice that in able to run this race, we have to lay aside anything that might hinder us. Of course, he mentions sin, but there are other things that distract us and would restrict our movements. Again, the imagery here is that of an athlete in training who is shedding his extra weight that he doesn't need in order to compete successfully, or she is getting rid of during training. So the idea is that when we run, nothing is distracting us. And we know all too well how the world wants to distract us if we are running our race of life in Jesus Christ. They want to distract us from our faith in Jesus Christ and tell us it's not important. Now what's important is modern technology. What is important are modern inventions. What is, put your trust in modern day science and medicine. The apostle is reminding us that none of these can compare to the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ, and so we want to get rid of those distractions and run our race with our focus on Jesus Christ. As he tells us these first two instructions, he now comes to the real nuts and bolts of his advice. He now is telling us what we really need to know in order to run the race of life as part of a community of faith. We are to run the race of life with endurance, since normally the race of life is a long-distance event and not a sprint. Life is only a sprint if our life is cut tragically short. But if we live a normal life, then it is a long-distance race, so we must have endurance. Or as So the apostle is making it clear to us that running the race of life is not going to be easy. It's not going to be quick. It's going to be long. It's going to be arduous. It's going to be difficult. And so we have to have this patience in order to master the race course. Now, some people today don't want to hear the word patience or perseverance. And that is because many describe our society today as a microwave society. We're used to everything happening instantly. We're not used to waiting on things. We take a meal that used to take 2 or 3 hours to fix, we pop it in a microwave and it's done in a couple of minutes. News that used to take us a day or two to hear, we can see instantly through the internet, through television and radio, through texting and through Twitter and all these other things that you can have on your phone. We can immediately have contact with someone where we weren't able to before. So we're not used to being patient because we have everything at our fingertips. You go to the computer and get on the internet and do research and you have information in just minutes that used to take you hours to discover in a library, pulling down volume after volume after volume of a book. I wish we had internet when I was in seminary. It would have made seminary a lot easier instead of going through all those bookshelves and all those card catalogs. So people find it difficult today to have patience, to have endurance, but this is what we must have in order to run the race of life and be successful. We have to have that endurance. We cannot expect everything in life to happen quickly, although we may be sure. All of us here today have experienced pain in some form or another. Some of us today may be in pain right at this moment. And it is common that when we have pain, we want it to disappear instantly. But rarely does that happen. Even with all the medicines and even with all the treatments we have today, pain just doesn't go away like that. Medicine takes time to work, so we have to have that patience. Patience to master. When I was in the hospital and my shoulder was beginning to become painful from my surgery, and I would call the nurse and ask for pain medicine. Well, they would give me that pain medicine, but that pain didn't disappear immediately. I had to have the patience to let it work, and that what gave me the perseverance to wait for it to work was knowing that it would work and the pain would disappear for a number of hours. And so we have to be able to endure, to have that endurance, that perseverance. We have to run our race of life with that because it is not a sprint. We have to have patience, we have to have endurance, and to have that endurance, and to have the stamina we need in order to run the race of life, the apostle is telling us there's something else we need to do. And that is, we need to keep our eyes, quote, looking to Jesus. Looking to Jesus. That word translated as looking means to keep your eyes upon the finish line. It means to focus on something. It means to lock onto it. We focus on Jesus and his example in handling pain and suffering, adversity and misery, joy and celebration, triumph and life itself. Like a runner coming out of the last turn and heading down the home stretch, we lock our eyes on the finish line. We focus on that finish line and keeping our eyes on the finish line so that we can run our fastest and reach that finish line. So it is with running the race of life. We lock our eyes on Jesus. And we look to Jesus because, as the apostle says, he is a, quote, founder and perfecter of our faith. Or as your insert says, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. The word founder or pioneer literally means to be a trailblazer. In a lesser sense, it means to be an example to follow. But more importantly, it means trailblazer. What's a trailblazer? A trailblazer is one who goes first. Or one who lays out a trail for you to follow. Jesus Christ is our trailblazer, and that he laid out the path, cleared the path, made the path for us to reach salvation. He made the path leading to God the Father so that we could reestablish a relationship with God, which had been broken by sin, and so that we could then have not just a relationship with God, but a personal relationship with God. And that personal relationship with God enables us to commune with God directly. We can approach God without any interference. We need no human go-between, because Jesus Christ is our go-between. Jesus Christ is our intercessor. Now, many of the religions of the world, you have to have a go-between. You have to have a priest, or a rabbi, or an imam, or a shaman, or a witch doctor, or a monk, or some person, religious person, who goes to God on your behalf, and who intercedes with God. Well, because Jesus Christ, our trailblazer, took care of all of that, each and every one of us now have a direct line to God through Jesus Christ. Oftentimes, and every pastor can tell you that they've had the same experience, that oftentimes people come up to me and they will say, "Pastor, will you pray for this or that because you have a direct line?" I hope when people tell me that, that they're joking. Because if not, they have a poor understanding of the Christian faith and the trailblazing work of our Lord Jesus Christ. Each and every one of us have the same direct line to God through Jesus Christ. My prayers are no greater than yours. If I pray to God for something or on your behalf, my prayer is no more important to God than your own prayer. Now, that's not saying for you to not ask me to pray for something, because the Bible tells us that there's power in prayer, and more people praying together, the more powerful that prayer is. But don't think that somehow my line is more direct than yours. It's the same. And we don't need anybody to interfere. We don't need anybody else to carry that prayer to God through Jesus Christ. All we need is Jesus Christ. That's the point that Hebrew makes earlier in this letter, which some scholars think is actually a sermon. But he is emphasizing the point. Jesus is our great high priest. Jesus is our intercessor. Jesus is the trailblazer. He's cleared the way. It is similar to, and from our nation's history, to give an example of Daniel Boone, who blazed the trail through the Cumberland Gap into Kentucky to open up Western expansion for this new nation called the United States of America. And like Daniel Boone and others, would trailblaze westward and make trails for people to follow after them so they could settle in the Midwest and the South and on out to the far west. So Jesus has done that for us. Through his death on the cross, he has blazed that trail so that we have that relationship with God. The word perfecter means to complete something or to make it complete. It means to reach the goal. Through Jesus Christ's sacrificial death upon the cross, he completed God's plan of salvation, offering his blood and death as a final sacrifice to pay the debt of sin for all people and to receive upon himself the full wrath of God so that we who believe in him might be free from that wrath. This is why Jesus could say that sixth word from the cross: "It is finished. It is completed. It is accomplished. I have reached the goal. I have made complete, Father, your plan of salvation. I have taken upon your wrath, and now my blood enables those who believe in me to truly be children of the Heavenly Father and heirs to the kingdom." Without Jesus' sacrifice upon the cross, it would be impossible for us to escape God's wrath for the sins that we do. So to accomplish this, to accomplish freeing us from that wrath, as the apostle tells us, Jesus endured the cross. Now the word translated here for endured is different than the word of the sentence above, endurance, where endurance meant the patience to master something. Here the word translated as endure means to sustain a load, to sustain a misery, to be able to sustain adversity. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, sustained the load of the sins of the world. He sustained the misery of God's wrath. He sustained the adversity of being separated from his Father so that we could reap the benefits of his actions, so that we could have salvation by faith through grace apart from works of the law. Being reminded of his great sacrifice and focusing our eyes on Jesus' life and actions, we can run the race of life with confidence. Running the race of life, we do not have to be afraid. We do not have to fear, no matter how difficult the race course may become, as we continue running the race of life. By focusing on Jesus Christ, we can make it to the finish line and join that great cloud of witnesses who've gone before us in the faith. Joining that great cloud of witnesses in cheering on and encouraging those loved ones we leave behind who must still run their race of life, focusing on Jesus Christ as well. Many medals will be handed out in the Olympic Games this summer. Medals for first, second, and third place in all the different events. And yet, as valued as those medals may be to the athletes who win them and to the nations who the individual represents, no matter how valued they are to them, they cannot compare to those of us who continue to fight the good fight to finish the race and to keep the faith. To us who run the race of life as God intends by having faith in his Son Jesus, we receive a medal far greater than Olympic gold. We receive the medal of eternal life and the never-ending kingdom of God. So let us continue to run our race of love, looking to Jesus. Peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing Blessed Be the Name on page 4 in your worship bulletin. And as we sing the hymn, the offering will be.
Blessed be the name, and as we're singing, blessed be the name, the offering is being received. We have the ushers today receiving the offering as we sing, blessed be the name. This is the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. Blessed be the name, written by W.H. Clark. Refrain added by Ralph Hudson. We're thankful to Jesus Christ who died for us, who gave himself for us, and we run the race with Jesus. Jesus is present in the tabernacle here with us today, and we believe in the real presence, and he is here because of the love of us. He loves us, and that is why he is here in the tabernacle. We give great respect to him, as he is the bread of heaven, come down from heaven to give us eternal life.
Thank you.
Due to the length of the prayers this morning, I will ask that you just remain seated and standing when we say the Lord's Prayer. So for the petitional prayers, please remain seated. Once they are finished, then please stand as we say the Lord's Prayer today. Let us pray in the name of Jesus to our Heavenly Father, for the church, the world, and one another. Our response today is to hear our prayer. Holy God, make your church a faithful witness to your word of law and gospel. When it must speak of casting fire, of judgment, and of sin, let it do so humbly and lovingly, but also honestly and fearlessly. Help it to constantly point to Jesus, the merciful pioneer and perfecter of faith, and the salvation for whom the world languishes. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Renew the faith, increase the zeal, and strengthen the needs of everyone in this congregation. Cast the purifying fire of your Holy Spirit in our midst, so that all we say and do is in accordance with your word, and so that through us, your will is accomplished in the lives of many people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bestow your richest blessings upon missionaries of the gospel, that many may come to faith in Jesus through their testimony. Bless also, we pray, our sister synods and congregations and our national church body. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We are surrounded by a cloud of faithful witnesses, including those Christians who are persecuted throughout the world, even in this age of tolerance and diversity. Help us to be strengthened and encouraged by their example. Give them patience and steadfast hearts, and through their witness, burn away the sin and purify the hearts of those who hate them and you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that your peace would be established among the nations, tribes, clans, sects, and communities of this world. No plan or project of ours can heal the seeds of wickedness and violence in our hearts. So we plead that your hand would reach out to heal, purify, guide, and direct the people and the leaders of governments, industry, education, and every other human endeavor in accordance with your will and for our common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide and direct the deliberations and discussions of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America as it meets in convention this week. Renew the faith and zeal of all who attend, and give them joy in sharing your gospel with those around them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Until your peace is established, good men and women must risk grave dangers to protect lives and liberty. We pray for all of them. Purify their minds and hearts, and direct their decisions and deeds, so that even places of chaos and violence, like in Milwaukee today, may begin to know a measure of your peace. Bring them safely home to their loved ones, and bless their hearts and lives with that same peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for everyone who is afflicted by the powers of sin, evil, and death, and who cries out for healing, comfort, and hope in the midst of suffering. Be their sure hope and strong deliverer, strengthen their faith in times of trial, and bring them safely through into the fellowship of those who love them and into closer communion with you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we humbly commend our departed loved ones in your care. Renew to us a promise you made to all the faithful who have gone before us. Keep our faith steadfast and firm in your excellent word until the day when you bear us in your bosom into your everlasting kingdom, and make us stand before you with all whom you have upheld by your righteous, omnipotent hand. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the powers of the Holy Spirit, we entrust our prayers and petitions into your hands, gracious Father, for the sake of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our souls. And may the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always. Amen. We conclude our worship with Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, page 6.
Our last hymn is written by William Chalmers Smith. He lived 1824 to 1903. Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Flowers today are given to the glory of God, presented by a pastor. Once the drive-in were presented by Pastor Gina in memory of Gina's father, Raymond Schwartz, on the anniversary of his birthday. Flowers in the chancel were given by Jen and Hope in memory of Roger. This is the 14th of August, 13th Sunday after Pentecost. Praise Christ, and he died on the cross. Save us from sin. His body and blood are to be presented on the altar next week. We have the service of the word this week. Next week we have the sacrament of Holy Communion. We believe in the real presence. We believe that the real presence is in the institution. Jesus Christ, for the love of us, is in the tabernacle with us today. On YouTube. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, with the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to come with us to worship in person. Some of the best people in Clark County are here. They're doing things for the community, serving food to those in need, providing all the things that people need. We're here at the church. We have our outreach store. We have our pantry. We serve 8,000 meals a month. We thank you for watching. We thank you for your prayers as you pray for our ministry, our YouTube ministry. We thank you that Jesus Christ died for our sins. His consecrated body is present with us in the tabernacle. Next week we will receive it. He's here for the love of us. He's present for the love of us, the bread of heaven, brought down from heaven, the food of angels. And we will receive this food next week. Jesus Christ provided this. He died for our sins, and he will give us eternal life through receiving his body and blood. Thank you for worshiping with us today. It's a little rainy today. We're going to still have our picnic. It is raining very hard, but we will be at the shelter house today for the picnic. See Jesus Christ, his resurrected body, prophet, priest, and king above the altar today.